Welcome to a Henry Ford College Science Laboratory. Whether you are about to embark on an exploration of biology or chemistry in your lab, it's important to recognize that you have the potential to be exposed to hazardous materials and dangerous situations. While lab accidents are rare, the most common types include illness from unwanted chemical or microbial exposure, cuts and other injuries from breakage of glassware and equipment, and minor or serious burns from heat, fire, or chemicals. Today, you will learn the proper procedures to prevent accidents and protect yourself from injury. You will also find out how to react to any emergencies that might occur in the lab. Additionally, you will learn how to use chemical labels and other reference materials to supplement your instruction on the proper handling of lab chemicals. Many safety precautions and procedures are simple common sense. Others may be activity specific for preventing injury to you and your lab partners. While lab activities here at HFC are set up with the greatest adherence to safety standards, you should never underestimate the potential for harm in any laboratory situation. Let's begin by taking a look at some different situations that may occur in the lab. Situation 1. You come to lab and have no idea what experiment you're doing in lab today, or how to do the experiment, or if there are any special safety precautions for today's experiment. Luckily, there are simple solutions for each of these problems. First, read the experiment instructions before lab. One of the most important things you can do to be successful and safe in lab is to carefully read thoroughly the experimental procedures before you come to lab. Then, if any procedure is unclear to you, you will already know what questions to ask before beginning. Be on time. Prompt attendance is mandatory. If you miss the safety and procedural instructions given at the start of lab, you may not be allowed to participate in that day's lab. Listen for the safety precautions. Your instructor will give you additional safety instructions. Ask questions if anything is unclear. Remember, if you start lab correctly by being prepared, not only will you be safer, but you will definitely have a more enjoyable and relaxing lab experience. Situation 2. Accidents occurring due to a messy lab or unprofessional behavior. Accidents and emergency situations can happen suddenly and unexpectedly. Here are some basic steps that you can take to minimize the likelihood of an accident. Begin by keeping the lab environment professional and neat. Keep all aisles clear. Be aware of materials that could pose a tripping hazard and keep them out of the aisles. Label and organize your test tubes, plates, flasks, or beakers when possible. Keep track of container contents and pay close attention to chemical names. Many chemical names look the same. Behave professionally while in the laboratory. Personally monitor your experiments at all times. Do not distract other students or interfere with other laboratory experiments. Never work alone in a lab. Students are not allowed to be in the lab without an instructor present. You must also perform only the experiments authorized by your instructor. Mixing of incompatible chemicals can cause fire or the creation of toxic byproducts. When you are finished, follow the instructions for your lab to clean your lab station and put away all chemicals and materials. Situation 3. Injury occurring due to chemical exposure or contamination. Whether you are in a chemistry lab or biology lab, you don't want to suffer any ill effects from the materials you're working with. So your goal must be to keep yourself and your personal effects from coming into contact with lab chemicals or microbes. To protect your personal items, silence your phone and keep it stored away from benchtops. Cell phone use and texting are prohibited in lab. Besides being a distraction, your phone can become damaged by chemicals or contaminated with lab bacteria. Bring only required materials to the lab benchtop. Store your backpacks, books, and purses in the location designated by your instructor. To protect your skin and eyes, proper lab attire is required. If your skin is not properly protected, you will be denied entry to that day's lab. The basic requirements are Shoes must completely cover the foot. Legs must be covered to the knees at minimum. Long hair, scarves, and head coverings must be tied back, and dangling jewelry and loose or baggy clothing must be secured. Besides basic attire, you may also need personal protective equipment. Your instructor will notify you if any of these are required. When noted, you will be required to wear your safety glasses or goggles until all activity is completed. Your instructor will provide you with additional protective equipment, such as lab coats, gloves, or aprons, if the procedure requires them. To protect yourself from accidentally ingesting or absorbing any hazardous materials, food and beverages are not allowed in lab, no exceptions. This includes chewing gum, applying cosmetics, or applying lip balm. This rule is also a Michigan law for all laboratories that handle hazardous chemical or biological materials. Please refrain from removing or inserting contacts while in the lab. Contacts can easily absorb any residual chemical or biological material that may be on your hands. And of course, always wash your hands thoroughly after lab. Lab chemicals and lab bacteria are not something you want to rub off into your food, clothing, or cell phones. If after taking all precautions, you still find yourself exposed to a chemical or biological hazard, use the safety equipment in your lab to remove any contamination. The safety equipment available to you in the event of unwanted chemical or biological contact varies by lab type. Take a few seconds to look around and find these safety items. Know the fastest route to get to them if needed. Consider that your vision may be impaired in an emergency situation. Use the sink to wash off any contamination to your hands or arms. You may need to rinse the exposed area for a minimum of 15 minutes. Use the eye wash if any chemical liquid or powder gets into your eyes. Hold eyelids open and move your eye up and down and sideways to wash thoroughly behind the eyelids. Rinse for a minimum of 15 minutes. Use the safety shower for large chemical splashes to the body. Remove contaminated clothing and flush the affected area for a minimum of 15 minutes. Always notify your instructor of any exposure incident, no matter how minor it may seem. Situation 4. Injury occurring from damaged equipment or glassware, or from improper use of equipment. Carefully examine all equipment and read the instructions before use. Do not use or allow anyone else to use damaged equipment and notify your instructor of any problems. Never operate electrical equipment with wet hands. If you're using sharp instruments, follow all safety instructions. Examine all glassware before each use. Never use chipped, cracked, or dirty glassware. Chipped or cracked glassware can break or explode upon heating. If any glassware is broken, notify your instructor and use care when cleaning up. Follow the instructions for your lab. Never pick up broken glass with bare hands. Use a broom and dustpan or forceps. Do not dispose of broken glass or sharp objects in with regular trash. Place broken glass or sharp objects in the designated disposal container for your lab. If you cut yourself, notify your instructor immediately. First aid kits are available in lab for minor injuries. You must notify your instructor of all bleeding injuries. If a classmate is injured, please be aware that contact with even small amounts of blood can pass on diseases such as hepatitis B. Treat all blood as though it were infected. Wear gloves and avoid contact. While bandages with small spots of blood can be wrapped in a paper towel and disposed in the trash, larger amounts of blood require the use of a biohazard bag and may not be put in the trash. Situation 5, injury occurring due to heat or flame. Bunsen burners and hot plates are common laboratory equipment, and they are also common sources of lab injuries and accidents. Remember to keep your hair, clothing, and hands at a safe distance from heat and flames at all times. Never reach over burner flames because a properly adjusted flame is not always easy to see and can result in a burn. Never leave a lit burner or anything being heated or visibly reacting unattended. Never look into or point the open end of a container at yourself or anyone else while it's being heated. Be particularly careful when working with flammable liquids. Keep flammable liquids such as alcohol and acetone away from hot plates and burner flames. Hot plates can spark and ignite flammable liquids or vapors. Be aware that the vapors themselves can catch fire and travel back to the liquid, even if it's placed far from the flame. And never pour a flammable liquid on an already burning substance. This is all advice you should heed even outside the lab. If you do burn yourself, immediately run the burned area under cold water. Inform your instructor. Get medical attention for any burn that raises a blister or breaks the skin. Notify your instructor immediately if a fire occurs in the lab. If anything or anyone catches on fire, do not panic. If your clothing or hair catches fire, drop to the floor and roll. If you see someone with their hair or clothing on fire, push them to the floor and use the fire blanket to smother the flames. A fire blanket can also be used to smother other small fires. And a small contained fire in a beaker can easily be put out by covering it with a watch glass or a larger beaker. There are also fire extinguishers in your lab that may be used for small fires. To use a fire extinguisher, remember pass. P. Pull the pin in the trigger handle. A. Aim the nozzle at the base of the flames. S. Squeeze the handle. S. Sweep from side to side, starting at the front edge and moving toward the back edge. Never use a fire extinguisher on a person. The chemicals in the extinguisher can be harmful. If the fire is too large to extinguish immediately, evacuate the building and sound the fire alarm. Situation 6, chemical or biological spill. If any hazardous substance is spilled in lab, you must notify your instructor. Spill kits are available in every lab. The kits will vary depending on the types of materials found in your lab. Make sure you know where the kits are and what they are used for. Your instructor should show you the proper use of the kits for your lab. Always wear appropriate protective gear, such as gloves and safety glasses or goggles, before cleaning chemical or biological spills. Situation 7, disposal of waste. You must dispose of chemicals and biohazardous materials properly. Hazardous waste must not go in with regular trash or down the drain. Your instructor and some lab manuals will notify you when your experiment generates waste that requires special disposal. Make sure you know which materials must be placed in special waste containers, and do not leave used filter paper, test tubes, slides, or other waste sitting on counters or outside of their designated waste containers. Now think back to what you've just learned. Remember that you must notify your instructor of any chemical splash in your eyes or on your skin, any injury to you or your lab partner, any fire in the lab, and any hazardous material spill in the lab. If you need to contact campus safety in an emergency, there are phones located in every lab and emergency call boxes located in every hallway. The college also has automatic external defibrillators in the hallways for use if someone collapses and their heart is not beating properly. You may be asked to bring it to someone in an emergency. Take note of where they are when you leave lab today. And finally, if you would like to know more about the chemicals that you're working with in your lab, here is how you may find that information. Your instructor and your lab manual will give you general information and cautions about the materials that you will be using. You can find additional sources of information from container labels and safety data sheets. The hazards of a material are required to be on its label, but you must be able to interpret the label symbols in order to understand that information. Recently, the standards for labeling hazards have changed. Until the old labels are phased out, you must be able to interpret the information, pictograms, and warning symbols used on all labels. For old labels, the hazard diamond and hazard bar rank each chemical on a scale of 0 for low hazard to 4 for high hazard in the categories of health risk, flammability, and reactivity. They may also contain symbols for protective equipment if needed. New labels contain pictograms symbolizing the type of hazard, along with a signal word, hazard statements, and precaution statements. When a pictogram is used, it means that this type of material is hazardous, and the signal word, hazard statements, and precaution statements tell you exactly how it is hazardous and what precautions you should take to prevent injury. Safety data sheets are reports put out by the manufacturer or distributor of a chemical or product which contains specific chemical information, as well as all hazardous information. Safety data sheets can be found online through basic searches or directly from the manufacturer's website. HFC has an SDS database that contains SDSs for all chemicals used in HFC's chemistry and biology labs. Students may log in and search this database by going to the web address sds.hfcc.edu. Now that you know the basics of lab safety, you will receive a laboratory safety contract. The contract lists these plus many additional lab safety rules. You must completely read the contract and sign it before you will be allowed to work in the lab. If you have any questions about the material presented today or in the safety contract, please ask your instructor. You are now ready to have a safe and enjoyable lab experience.